with the videos, but he's going to introduce it, guys, so don't turn it on. But I'm just grateful for his faithfulness through these years. And remember, next Sunday is our I Love My Church Sunday. And if you think of somebody you could write a note to, bring a gift card to, do something, bake some oatmeal cookies with butterscotch in them. And that, how's that sound? Anybody want to put requests up on the board? If you like me, I like this, or whatever it might be. With the cost of ammunition right now, I do shoot 9mm and 40 caliber. And all right, Brother Johnny, come introduce.
Put this down to a man size, amen. Ladies, that was beautiful singing. I want to sign you up and bring you to Southeast Asia. That was fantastic. Thank you for that beautiful song. We're going to show a short 5-minute video in just a moment, but I want to introduce it because the only word, if there's music and pictures, it's just faces. But every one of those faces are foreign to you. But every one of those faces, it's a story to me. And I was thinking while I was sitting in the back there, about 9 years ago, I came here. And at that time, I wasn't one of your best friends because I used to coach against your basketball team. Somebody say amen. How you doing, Steve Rowe? Amen. We were reminiscing about basketball. I said, that game you lost 83-82, bro, you blew it. You should have won. You should have went to a zone defense, but that's okay. He's never been the sharpest knife in the drawer. Amen. Amen. That's right. Yeah. But by the way, what an amazing story about his accident. He shared the story with me today. I knew about the accident. I had no clue about how God just used that thing to see the salvation of a couple people and that type of thing. Amazing story. And thank God for Steve. He's a good guy. Not a good Christian, but a good guy. Amen. How you doing, Sergio? Usually I give this to Sergio. Where I told Sergio today, I said, Sergio, what are you doing here? Every church I go to, you're there. He keeps getting excommunicated everywhere I go. So anyway, so I thought I'd cut you some slack and give Steve a hard time. But anyway, the video we're going to show is, I was thinking about this while I was sitting in the back. 9 years ago, I came here to present our work, and I had no clue what we were going to do. We were going to a communist country, and to be honest with you, because of my age and everything, and I'm in the same drawer, Steve. I'm not the sharpest knife in the drawer either. I just didn't think we'd ever make a difference. But I remember when I took a 3-week survey trip, and I've told the story here, but I saw a little Hmong girl. She was 4 years old. She was staring at me. I'm staring at her. And God just broke my heart. And I told God, I said, God, if I'll go, I'll be willing to go. I don't know if I can make any difference whatsoever, but I'll be willing to go if I can make the difference in one life. And I remember as I saw her face and God broke my heart, and I knew I would never be the same. And so the last 8 years, as you've been faithfully supporting us, actually 9 years, started when we were on deputation, and praying for us, I want you to see the fruit of your labor. Almost every person you're going to see in this video is saved today. They're former Muslims. They're former Buddhists. They're former animists. And many of them are just absolutely doing great works for God. And God has allowed me to have a little bit of an impact in some of their lives. But I couldn't do it. None of the missionaries could do it without you. Your prayers and your giving. I was so encouraged when I heard pastors say that during the pandemic and everything else that went on, your missions giving didn't go down. It went up. Somebody say amen. Amen. By the way, that's a sign of a healthy church. And Pastor Bobby, I want to say this. Thank you for being faithful. I think you said 39 years, 40 years. Thank you for being faithful. Brother Beal, thank you for being faithful all these years. And all of you who are on staff, but you too, man, all these years. Thank you for being faithful. This is a wonderful church. And every missionary that you pray for and every missionary that you support has stories like these. Now, you're just going to see faces, but these are wonderful people that have been touched by the love of Christ. I hope you enjoy the video.
Count what was done for Christ.
The last picture you saw there is Pastor Cetone, if you would remember to pray for him. He's the one who's been in jail for 11 months. He was arrested at a baptismal service. He started a church about 3 years ago, and really the only reason that he's in jail is because he was successful in his ministry, and many people got saved, many people got baptized. The ministry got so big they could no longer meet in his house. They actually had to meet outside, and that drew attention. And again, of course, in the country where we serve, most of everything we do is under the radar, illegal. And apparently somebody in the village got upset, and that's how it works over there. And they went to the authorities, and he's been in jail for 11 months, almost a year, just under a year. And through Samaritan's Compassion, we've been able to support his family and be a blessing and help to them, as well as many, many others. But if you'll remember to pray for him, Pastor Cetone. And the amazing thing is, it's a little bit like Acts chapter 8, and it actually will go with my message this evening. But, you know, his church didn't die after he went to jail. As a matter of fact, his church grew, people were getting saved, and now the one church is five churches. Somebody say amen. Amen. So, you know, there's always a silver lining behind the clouds. Amen. So if you have a Bible, turn to the book of Philippians. I should have had a microphone to tell you, you know, those are Muslims there and that type of thing. But I'm not too swift. Amen. If you have a Bible, Philippians chapter 1, I do want to remind you the book's in the back, peeking through the 1040 window. I wrote it about 5 or 6 years ago when I first went to the field. It has a little bit of my personal testimony, my experiences when I first went there, as well as a lot of statistics about that part of the world. And there is no set price. All the proceeds are going to Southeast Asia to help families and so on. And then we also have prayer cards. My wife says, Johnny, you're like a politician, so I probably already got you with a prayer card. I'm pretty good. I'm like a used car salesman. Amen? So you probably got one. But those are at the back table. If you have a Bible, turn to Philippians chapter 1. And let's stand, if you could. And boy, I could have swore you said I'm supposed to be done at 7:15, and it's 7:18, so I'm going to have to really preach fast. So.
45.
Oh, he said 9:45. Okay. That's another thing. My wife says I need a hearing aid. Amen. Okay, Philippians chapter 1, just before I read these verses, we're going to just read three verses, just a little bit of background. You say, wow, we got to stand up. It'll help you stay awake. Philippians is written by the Apostle Paul. He's in jail. He's writing to a church that he started in Acts chapter 16. You remember in Acts chapter 16, he wanted to go northeast to what we would call Turkey today, but God stopped him and led him west to Macedonia, the Macedonian vision. And he starts the church in Philippi. It's a great church. As a matter of fact, when you read the letter to the Philippians, there's very few problems, a couple small problems. It's not like the Church of Corinth, needless to say, or the different churches in Galatia, but it's a good church. Paul has not seen them in probably 5 or 6 years, and he writes a letter, and it's a wonderful letter. If you saw the online discipleship, these are men I was discipling in Asia, but I'm not there anymore, so we do it online. But right now, with 5 of the 6 men, we're going through biblical principles from the life of the Apostle Paul and the letters of the Apostle Paul. And we're actually going through Philippians right now. So the book of Philippians is just a great book, so many lessons. The theme for the book, different themes, the gospel-centered life, joy amidst suffering. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I'm going to share a little bit of what I shared this morning, sort of part two, if you would. Philippians chapter 1, and I did bring my glasses, amen, because I was struggling this morning. Okay, Philippians chapter 1, thank you, sir. Philippians chapter 1, verse number 12, the Bible says, "But I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me," in other words, the reason I'm in jail, The things which have happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel, so that in my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. In other words, Paul said, I'm in jail. Look, I don't want to be here. I'm in jail, but it's working out for the good. All things work together for good to those who love God, called according to his purpose. He said, it's leading to the furtherance of the gospel. In other words, I'm able to share the gospel with prison guards, with other prisoners, and so on. Now, by the way, most of us don't want to start a prison ministry that way, but Paul had a positive attitude, amen. He says, so that in my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and all other places. Verse number 14 is interesting. And many of the brethren in the Lord waxing confident by my bonds. In other words, there's some brothers in Christ who they have now got confidence and courage because of Paul's faithfulness in the midst of his suffering. And I think about Pastor Citone and his church family. That's exactly what happened to them. Some of them just got some courage and bravery and boldness after he was in prison and doing some amazing things for God. So he says, and many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we do love you tonight. I'm thankful for Faith Baptist Church, the church family. What a wonderful service tonight, wonderful service this morning. The singing, the fellowship has been sweet. The message this morning was a tremendous message. I'm thankful for the faithfulness. So many faces, Lord. I probably preached here the first time maybe 20 years ago. So many folks that have just been in their place and faithful. And we're thankful for them. And we're thankful, Lord, for their just hearing about it. Guys going to the mission field, and somebody just arrived a couple weeks ago, and some planning on going. It's just so exciting, especially for me as a missionary, to hear that. I pray that you'd bless our time together this evening. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. Again, I love the book of Philippians, and one reason I love the book of Philippians, because if you're a Christian, if you've been a Christian for any length of time, You've went through a little bit of suffering. Somebody say amen. And you've had struggles and you've had trials. And the book of Philippians, the Apostle Paul reminds us, in the midst of my suffering, my trials, and my troubles, I can rejoice in the Lord always. Somebody say amen. And by the way, we were taught when we went to Bible college, Pastor Goddard and I, hello, we were taught that the Christian life is not measured in years, but in decades. But if you're going to stay faithful over decades, you have to understand the truth that this book portrays. Suffering's going to come. The Christian, you have to endure hardness as good soldiers of Jesus Christ. Everything's not going to be fun. I'll never forget the night I got a phone call at 3:00 in the morning in Kunming, China. My wife and I had been in Kunming, China for about 5-6 months at that time. And it was my youngest daughter, Joy. And Joy said, Dad, you need to read the text messages on the family feed. And first I said, Joy, do you know what time it is in China? It's 3:00 in the morning. And she said, Dad, you need to read the text messages on the family feed. And my son Joshua and my daughter-in-law, Hannah, their baby girl just died. And I had to fly back from China to do the funeral for my granddaughter. The most difficult thing that I've ever done in my life. But the Apostle Paul was a man who understood suffering, and he understood trials, he understood troubles, and he always stayed faithful. And he always, like we said this morning, he looked up. He didn't look down. He looked around. He didn't look within. He always stayed faithful. When I think about this passage of Scripture where Paul says, you know, I'm in jail. I don't really want to be here, but God's really working it out for the good. I think about over the last 11 months, COVID, restrictions, you know, peaceful protests that became riots and political divisiveness and just all the things that have gone on. And it's not been a lot of fun at all. Somebody say amen. I mean, March was the longest 10 years of my life. Somebody say amen. I remember telling my wife, is March ever going to end? And 2020, I mean, nobody will ever forget 2020. Somebody say amen. But it's been a difficult time. But, you know, we need to have the attitude of the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul would have said to you and me today, the things that have befallen us, and you fill in the blank.
Come on, amen.
You fill in the blank. Yes. Loss of a loved one. Cancer. Losing my job. You fill in the blank. We all have something that we can fill in the blank. Paul would say, there's a purpose. There's a plan. There's something that God is trying to do in your life. And one of the things is for the furtherance, can everybody say the gospel?
Yeah.
For the furtherance of the gospel.
Amen.
I've for the last 11 months, stuck here in America, I've tried to remind people, look, anytime troubles come, there's three things that God is trying to do. Number one, he's always, first and foremost, trying to draw us closer to him. Always. You know, we don't do real good on the mountaintop. Somebody say amen. We sort of struggle when everything's going well. But, you know, when we're in the valley, when the troubles come, when the trials come, when my father got murdered, when my mother died of cancer in Mexico, and we were trying to get medicine for her that wasn't legal here, and she died, and I was supposed to be there. When my 13-year-old nephew came out of a Wednesday night Bible study at Gethsemane Baptist in Long Beach, ran across the street, was hit by a car, and ushered into eternity. When my sister died, when I was taking my basketball team up to a tournament in North Valley, and I get a phone call at the airport that my sister just went to heaven. All of those things were difficult. They were trying times. But can I tell you something? It was those moments and many others like those moments. When my brother got hospitalized, on the night that I opened up our missions conference, almost 8 years ago, and he got hospitalized, it was those moments that I drew closer to God. I drew closer to God. But there's a second thing that God is doing always during the time of troubles and trials. He's trying to not only draw us closer to him, he's trying to conform us more into the image of Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You know, I don't know, you may not have this problem, but you know, I don't always act like Jesus. Somebody say amen. I just saw Steve Rowe saying, yeah, he never acted like Jesus. Amen. You know, can I just say something? But there's something about going through that valley. There's something about going through the trials where God, you know, sometimes, you know, we're supposed to examine ourselves daily. But if we're honest, sometimes we don't. But there's nothing like going through a trial where there's some self-examination. So number one, he's drawing us closer to him. Number two, he's trying to conform us more into the image of Christ. But number three, and this really is the thought tonight, during difficult times, he's always trying to draw us into a place of greater commitment to the cause of Christ and the gospel of Christ. And that's what Paul's talking about here. Because as Pastor said, you know, we don't, look, there's one thing that we are not going to be able to do when we get to heaven. We're going to be able to worship God. We're going to be able to read the Word of God. We're going to be with the Word of God. Somebody say amen. And we're going to be able to do so many wonderful things, but we're not going to be able to tell people about Jesus. Because there will be no need for that up there. Because everybody who's going to get saved will be there. Somebody say amen. So tonight I'd like to sort of elaborate a little bit about what I mentioned this morning. My wife and I came here in March, near the end of March, and, you know, we arrived, and we had to do the quarantine, and, you know, we're supposed to be on a furlough, and there's no furlough. Everything's online. All the churches are saying, well, can you do a video and give it to us, you know? And so they're doing videos, and I'm telling my wife and saying, this is a little bit different furlough. Somebody say amen. And then, you know, I'll never forget, Pastor, we did our two-week quarantine, and Joseph Esposito, my nephew, asked me, can you come do a Zoom Bible college class for us? So the first time I'm out of the house, 2 weeks, I'm in prison, I get out of the house, I go do a Zoom Bible class, and I break out with a fever. Somebody say amen. So I have to go back to the house, and I quarantine myself in the house from my wife. She stays on one side of the house. I stay on the other side of the house. We're both wearing masks. She won't come anywhere near me. She says, you want to eat, make your own food. Somebody say amen. So I'm going through all this, and I'm trying to, in my feeble mind, I'm trying to, Lord, what in the world are you trying to do? And as I mentioned this morning, a couple things happened. Pastor Cetone went to jail, and I told the story about he's now Pastor Subin, was not at that time. He started our COVID church. But he's out looking for bugs to feed his family because he doesn't have any money. And then there's a Pastor Toe, a man that I worked with some in Cambodia, and he's a tuk-tuk driver. That's what he does for a living, to support him and his family. He's got two children who are very, very ill, and just sad story. So we begin to help them, and then I'm preaching at a church in the San Diego area, and they're meeting outside. They have two services, one service, a 15-minute break, another service, and they're disinfecting everything. And so I preach, and I happen to tell some of these stories. And as I tell some of these stories, during the break, the pastor went with his, I don't know if it was his deacons, his staff, and I didn't even know, but they went in a back room, and in a matter of a couple minutes, in the next service, he made an announcement. He said, you know, when Brother Johnny was preaching, when he was talking about there's no stimulus package, there's no unemployment for our brothers and sisters in Christ there in Southeast Asia, he said, God really convicted me. He said, so we, the deacons or whoever he talked to, we're going to write out a check for $20,000. $10,000 will go to Brother Johnny and his ministry, and $10,000 will go to Dave Board, because I was mentioning Cambodia. And Pastor, it was that day I looked at my wife. I said, that's one of the reasons I'm here.
Amen.
That's one of the reasons I'm here. And so for the last 10 months or so, we have been able to raise, I think I mentioned this morning, we've been able to raise $50,000 to send to churches and to people in Southeast Asia to meet their needs. Now, it never would have happened if I was in Laos. But yeah. I hate asking for money. I remember when that was like one of those divine moments where God really helped me to see, son, this is one of the reasons I have you here, to help the poor, the needy, and the helpless, your brothers and sisters in Christ there in Asia. Because had I been in Asia, first of all, if we didn't have COVID, the problem wouldn't be nearly as bad as it was in that type of thing. And so God has used us to be a tremendous blessing in the midst of the burden. Now, here's my question for you today. Because I've been sort of like an outsider looking in. America's no longer my home. I don't consider it home. I'm glad to be here to be with our grandchildren and good to report to the churches. But I'm sort of like an outsider now looking in, and here's what I've noticed. That far too many Christians, in the midst of the burden, the trials, and the suffering, have been whining and complaining and crying. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Christian snowflakes, I guess. Somebody say, I have no idea. And I'm thinking, do we believe the Bible? I mean, like, is the Bible true? We're in the midst of a global pandemic. We're in the midst of maybe some government overreach. We're in the midst of all the... By the way, can I just remind my American brothers and sisters in Christ? This is the way the rest of the world lives all the time. Yeah. Somebody say amen.
That's right.
That where I live, this is how it is all the time. Okay? Well, we want our freedom of speech. Well, of course we want our freedom of speech, but can I tell you something? Nobody else has it. Somebody say amen. So you are starting to experience on a small scale, a very small scale, what your brothers and sisters in Christ all around the world have been experiencing for 2,000 years. And so I've watched, especially if you go online, you know, social media, boy, you have to take medication after social media. So I'm saying, and the Christians are the worst. It's like, you gotta be kidding me. I can't believe he just said that. Can't believe she just said that. But here's the thing. We need to have the attitude of the Apostle Paul. We need to learn to take the high road.
Yes.
We need to learn. Look at, can I just say something? If the government locks the doors of every church, God is still on his throne. Christ is still Lord of all. The Holy Spirit is still in our heart. The Word of God is still true. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And the church of Jesus Christ can still go forward, and the gates of hell shall not, cannot, and may I say, will not prevail.
Amen.
Somebody say amen. It doesn't matter what the government does. By the way, the last few years, we've become so politically minded, we're no longer heavenly minded. Somebody say amen. I don't know about you, but I know Pastor and I, we were taught years ago, the answer has never been in the White House. It's always been in God's house. Somebody say amen. By the way, the answer is not in the Constitution. It's in the Word of God. Somebody say amen. And so what I'm trying to say tonight is the Apostle Paul is trying to remind you and me, it doesn't matter what comes our way. God is going to use it. All things. Can everybody say all things?
All things.
Not some things. Not 80% of the things. Not 90% of things. All things work together for good to those who love God and who are called according to his purpose. So what we need to do as the people of God, we need to get a little bit of what Paul had. Paul said, look, boy, we could read more verses. Paul said, look, I'm in jail. I don't want to be here. And by the way, trust me, that jail was nothing like our jails. Somebody say amen. No HBO, no getting a master's degree. Somebody say amen. Paul's in jail. He doesn't want to be there. But Paul says, God's allowed me to be here.
Yep.
And God's allowed me to be here for a reason. And one of the reasons is simply this, for the furtherance of the gospel.
Yes.
And then Paul says, man, I get to share the gospel with prisoners I never would have been able to meet. Somebody say amen. But that's what you call a good attitude.
Yes.
Amen. I get to share the gospel with the prison guards I never would have had a chance to meet. Then he says, not only that, because I'm in jail, he said, some of the brethren have become bold and they're sharing the gospel, and so more people are getting saved. Somebody say amen.
Yeah, amen.
Now, you and me, what we would be doing is whining and complaining and saying, oh, pray for me that I get out of jail. Now, Paul's saying, extend my time. Somebody say amen. Then he goes on, we didn't read the verse, he goes on to say, you know, some of the guys are preaching with bad motives. They're trying to get me in more trouble. Here's what Paul says. As long as the gospel is being preached, I'm going to rejoice. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So tonight, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what the church is going through. But I do know this. God's on his throne.
Yes.
I do know this. Christ is Lord.
Yes.
He's Lord of all. He's Lord over the pandemic. He's Lord over what's going on in the White House. God knows everything. Somebody say amen. He God, look at Jesus Christ has Governor Newsom in check. Somebody say amen. Yeah. Well, you know, don't sweat the small stuff. You have to understand, when Paul wrote this, he was in the Roman Empire. He was in the government in a pagan society that would make America look like heaven. Ungodly, persecuting Christians, but Paul just thought differently. And because Paul thought differently, because the way I think determines the way I live. And so Paul not only thought differently, he lived differently. So I want to encourage you tonight, regardless, you know, people, you read online, well, persecution's coming. Well, you know, Jesus told us it was going to come anyway 2,000 years ago. Sometimes I wonder, dude, have you read the Bible? Oh, these are perilous times. Yeah, Paul talked a little bit about that. I mean, why are you shocked? Somebody say amen. You know why we're shocked? Because we're spoiled. We're spoiled. So tonight, the message is real simple. I don't know what you're going through. I thank God God's going through it with you. And God's going to use it to refine you. And God's going to use it to draw you closer to him and to make you a little bit more like him. And if you'll be sensitive and not stubborn, I tend to be a little bit stubborn, maybe you'll have a moment like I had when all of a sudden God said, Johnny, that's why you're here. That's why you're here. And so I have no clue how long I'm going to be here. But here's what I am going to do. I'm going to faithfully plod on and go forward for God. Amen. I'm going to do whatever I can. If I have to disciple online, teach Bible classes online, if I go to churches and we raise money and we send it back to this back to Southeast Asia. The truth is, don't tell anybody, I may be accomplishing more today than I was when I was in Southeast Asia. But I had to change the mindset. Because what I wanted to do was change my circumstances. But what God wanted to do was to change me. God is not worried so much about your circumstances and my circumstances. But God is greatly worried about us and changing us and molding us and making us so that we can be vessels meet for the Master's use, so we can accomplish what it is God wants for us to accomplish. So in the last 10, 11 months, people have been saved, people have been baptized, churches have been planted during COVID. And one of the reasons is because, unlike Paul, I wasn't sitting in jail, stuck in jail. I was stuck in America. Where are you stuck tonight? Wherever it is you're stuck, God has you there for a reason. Let's stand and let's pray. Our heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to give the invitation over to your pastor, but I do want to ask you a question or two this evening. You've been very attentive. I'm sure I've went way too long, but you've been very attentive. With our heads bowed, eyes closed, I wonder how many might say, you know, Brother Johnny, something you said tonight, God really spoke to my heart. And God is dealing with me right now. And while God's dealing with me, I want to do business with him as he does business with me. But God has spoken to my heart tonight. Brother Johnny, would you pray for me? Slip up your hand. We'll pray for you. Anyway, God bless you. Many, many hands. Thank you. God bless you. And I wonder if there's anybody here tonight, heads bowed, eyes closed. I wonder if there's anybody or a handful of people here tonight say, you know what? I've been feeling a little stuck. I've been a little bit discouraged about my circumstances, my situation. I've been bothered, a little bit confused on what the future holds. Can I just remind you, We may not know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. But tonight you say, I've been feeling a little stuck, a little bit discouraged. Brother Johnny, tonight God is speaking to me and helping me realize God has me right where I am for a reason. Brother Johnny, would you pray for me? Slip up your hand. We'll pray for you. God bless you. Many, many hands. I'm going to have a brief word of prayer, then I'll turn it over to your pastor. Father, you see the hands. You know our hearts. I pray, God, that you would do what only you can do. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Let's let the instruments play. You take a moment with the Lord, would you?